Who wants to see a magic trick? I have a run-of-the-mill standard Raspberry Pi 0W2, and I have a TFT display with a touch controller. It's pretty easy to connect the two, just plug them together. You will, however, note that I have no battery and I've not connected it to any power source. But what I do have is my nice Pi branded notepad. Well, what do you know? It's powered itself up. And if we give it a few seconds, it even boots into X Windows. Now, of course, the big question is, does it run Doom? And there we go. It runs Doom pretty well. So what's going on? What is this magic? Well, fans of the channel will recognise these wireless LEDs from previous videos. We can even power one of my wireless Christmas trees. And it works with my wife's phone. This was a slightly nervous moment. Blowing up your wife's phone is not a good thing. By now you'll have guessed it. We're playing around with some more wireless charging technology. I've been looking at a few wireless power options over the past year or so, but I've always found them to be slightly disappointing. They work well for simple stuff like LEDs, but I've struggled to use them for anything practical. So I thought, why not try a proper version? As you've seen, this one even works with your phone. Let's have a look at what it's actually capable of. I've hooked up the transmitter PCB to my USB power meter, so we can monitor the power going in. And I've got the receiver hooked up to my electronic load. With the USB supplying 5 volts, we can get up to almost 1 amp on the output before it collapses. The transmitter and receiver are both compatible with the iPhone wireless charging standard, so we can give it a go with my phone charger. Interestingly, this is using 9 volts for the transmitter side of things. With this, we can get up to about 1.2 amps. That's pretty impressive stuff. According to the docs, my transmitter board should be able to go up to 12 volts on its input. But when I tried this, the voltage on the receiver seemed to become quite unstable, and it would shut off at a relatively low load. I also noticed that the receiver PCB started to get quite warm. We're getting up to around 80 degrees centigrade on the receiver board when we run the transmitter at 12 volts. If we run the transmitter at 5 or 9 volts, it only goes up to a much more comfortable 50 degrees. Interestingly, the transmitter board doesn't seem too bothered by the supply voltage at all. There's only a temperature increase of around 5 or 6 degrees when running at 12 volts compared to 5 or 9 volts. Let's see if we can work out how efficient it is. I've rerun the tests and noted down the power input and the power output. We've got some interesting graphs. With the transmitter running at 5 volts, we seem to hit peak efficiency of around 73% at a load of around 0.5 amps, and we can get up to around 0.9 amps before we lose regulation. When the transmitter is running at 9 volts, we get peak efficiency of just under 70% at a load of 1.1 amps, and we can pull up to 1.2 amps from the system. The boards are supposed to be able to transmit 1.5 amps, and I think this is actually probably doable under the right conditions. You would need to get good alignment of the coils and the perfect distance between them. I'm also using a rectangular receiver coil with a round transmitter. Now, I'm not sure how much of an effect this has, but I'm sure it's probably not ideal. There are a lot of alternatives on AliExpress, some of them with multiple coils, which should give much better results. I've also tried to measure the transmitter range. I set up the load to draw 0.5 amps, and with a 5 volt input, we get around 1 centimeter of range. With the 9 volt input, this goes up to about 1.5 to 2 centimeters. That's pretty good, and you would normally arrange things so that there's not much between the transmitter and the receiver coils. The PCBs are remarkably simple. The receiver board has just one IC on it, along with some passive components. The CP2101, which should not be confused with the very common USB to UART bridge chip that we find on a lot of our dev boards, is doing all the heavy lifting. It's pretty amazing how much is packed into this one chip. On the transmitter side, we have a couple of ICs. The JW7951C is the transmitter chip. This is responsible for driving the coil and provides information on what the coil can see. The other chip is a bit of a mystery. It's probably some kind of microcontroller and power delivery control chip, but I can't find any reference to it anywhere. If you know what it is, then let me know in the comments. Now, while we're on the subject of PCBs, I should probably tell you about PCBWay, who are sponsoring this video. Why not have a go at designing your own PCB and send it off to them for manufacture? They'll even do SMD assembly for you. But back to the video. Now, obviously, you've already seen this working and powering the Pi, but just how much power does the Pi need to boot up and play Doom? Well, let's have a look. I've hooked it up to the USB power meter, and it uses a surprising amount of power, getting up to almost 0.6 amps when running the Doom demo. If you've watched the previous video, then you'll remember that under heavy load, the Pi Zero can draw around 400 milliamps, so our screen is adding quite a bit of load to the system, probably mostly with the backlight. However, It is well within the capabilities of the wireless power system, given what we've measured, but I found it surprisingly hard to get it to run consistently, and it would often brown out during booting, launching X-Windows, or running Doom. It took quite a few tries to get a good end-to-end take. The main issue is that when you can't see the coil, it's quite hard to get good alignment. This does explain why a lot of wireless chargers have locating magnets to snap your phone into position. Without them, you get a pretty ineffective charging system. Something to think about for the future projects. Now, what can we do with this? Obviously, we can't just have our Raspberry Pi only working when it's sat on top of the transmitting coil. That would be a bit rubbish. So let's make a complete wireless charging system with a battery. I've got a bunch of these basic boards that are based around the 4056 charge controller IC. We could hook one of these up with the battery and get it to charge. But I've also got these slightly nicer boards. These have the 4056 charge controller, and they have an adjustable boost converter which can output from 4.5 volts to 24 volts. In theory, this means that we should be able to run our Pi even when the battery voltage is quite low. So I've hooked it up to a battery, it's measuring just over 4 volts, but we have a bit of a problem. The output voltage is too high. It's 5.66 volts, and I can't seem to adjust it any lower. We should be able to go down to 4.5 volts, but the trim pot is already at the minimum. The Pi Zero might be just about okay with this slightly higher voltage. Looking at the datasheet of the power management IC, it will take up to 5.5 volts, and we're pretty close to that. But it would be nice to get exactly 5 volts. What's going wrong with our PCB? If we look at the datasheet for the boost converter on our board, we can see that the voltage output is controlled by this resistor divider. The top of this divider is this resistor. This has the code 104, which should be 100 kiloohms. Let's disconnect the battery and measure what we've actually got in circuit. Well, for the top resistor, we're measuring 57 kiloohms, and for the trim pot, when it's at its minimum, we've got 10k. It's not surprising that our output voltage is completely wrong. We need to either decrease the value of the bottom resistor or increase the value of the top resistor. Fortunately, we do have these through holes where we can add some additional resistors. I'm going to put a 100k resistor in parallel with the top resistor. This should give us a parallel resistance of around 78.5k. So with that done, we just need to reconnect the battery. And after a bit of fiddling with the trim pot, we can get almost exactly 5 volts on the output. I've no idea what's up with these resistors, but I've measured them on a bunch of the boards I've got, and they're all completely wrong. Some of them are closer to 100k, maybe within the 10% tolerance, but it's pretty rubbish. Well, let's see how much current we can get out of the step-up converter. I've connected it up to the electronic load, and we can easily draw 1 amp without the voltage dropping. So that's not bad at all. This will easily power our Pi Zero even with the screen and under heavy load. So I've hooked the board up to the wireless power receiver and it's charging nicely. I can see the voltage on the battery slowly going up, so that's working pretty well. And eventually our battery is fully charged. Now if we hook the board up to our Raspberry Pi with a nice switch so we can turn it off and on, everything works as normal. We've got a fully wireless Raspberry Pi. We'll give it a few seconds and it boots into X-Windows, and we can even run Doom without any problems. So I've been running it for a while and I wanted to check just how hot the boost board was getting when running the Pi at full pelt. And it's actually not too bad. The diode is getting a bit warm, but it's definitely not hot. So that's going to be pretty good for our future project. I did find some more boost boards in my stock of bits. These will boost up to 5 volts, and I've been thinking a bit about what I've built so far. It may be better to separate the boost circuit from the charge circuit. This would let us put a switch before the boost converter. The advantage of this is it will stop the boost circuit draining our battery even when we're not using the Pi, but we'll do that in the next video. Since we've been looking at Raspberry Pis, then check out this video. It's using a Pi Zero for radar motion detection, face detection, and it's got face recognition. It's definitely worth a watch. And if you're a fan of wireless power, then there's a whole bunch of videos in the playlist which should be up on your screen right now. Next video, we'll add sound and a controller to our Pi, and we'll have a fully portable Doom machine to play with.